Copland places us in a world, I think, far preferable to reality, oftentimes. This is such a tender piece. Gosh, I didn't even think about that. Tender land, right? No pun intended, truly. It's been a deeply meaningful, moving piece for us. Of course, has all this kind of romp and circumstance, but also these marvelous introspective moments. Look, we're doing the whole Tenderland opera a year from now. This was scheduled before I even knew that. So think of this as a little appetizer, a little taste of what is to come. It brings me great pleasure to welcome to the stage now the composer of our next piece, Mr. Joe Harkins. Come on up, it's great. Joe, welcome back to campus. Joe is now studying composition at Cincinnati Conservatory. He graduated from here a year ago. And we've had many wonderful conversations about life and about music, and oftentimes those aren't very separate of one another. And so, Joe, it's great to see you. Thank you. I'm getting my cheat sheet here so that I make sure we stay within the time limit here. Joe and I can talk for hours on end. So. I thought it'd be nice if we simply did that in front of you. Joe, what prompted you to write this symphony as opposed to any kind of other kind of piece?
Well, before I answer that, I just wanted to express my heartfelt thanks and gratitude to you and to this entire ensemble. I mean, I was a former student here, and I played with this group for 4 years, and to see it grow to what it has become, and to see them perform my own work is really a heartwarming experience, so I deeply thank you and the entire ensemble for your work on this. To answer your question, there are two primary reasons I called this a symphony. Of course, this is a symphony orchestra. So many of the pieces that an orchestra performs happen to be symphonic in nature, and it carries a little weight. When we think of orchestral literature, really, we think of, you know, Beethoven, Brahms, these colossal figures in music making. They carry this significance with it. And to dub a work, a symphony, also brings that weight along with it, right? And I felt that the character of this piece, the nature of the materials that I was using and how I was developing them, warranted such a title as symphony. Further, as the symphony as a sort of definition is also the congruence of disparate ideas. So I use a harmonic motive, I use a melodic motive, a rhythmic motive, and the combination of these creates a symphonic texture. I mean, it really is just a word that describes everything in it pretty well, and I thought that was applicable to this work in particular.
Can you tell us something about your compositional process, either in general, you know, how you go about composing music, how you approach that, or specifically with this particular piece?
My process involves crying at 3 a.m. and then after about 2 weeks of that, I actually start writing. A lot of the work that I do, I tend to conceptualize it in my mind before I put anything to paper. So for a work on this size, it took 4 months of just thinking and pondering and mulling over the ideas before it could actually be put to paper. And then even at that, really much of the gestation of this piece came between the hours of 12 a.m. and 5 a.m. when I had a lesson the next day at CCM and knew that I had to have something prepared. I say this all the time, you know, if it weren't for procrastination, nothing would get done. And my composition is a perfect example of that. Many of my best ideas have come when I've least expected it. You know, when we think through things, we tend to really think about them, and sometimes we overthink things. And in my work, that which I have overthought tends to be work that I just throw out the next morning anyway, or when I wake up, I should say. And with this, much of my experience of being awake at 4 a.m, putting things to paper, I wasn't thinking about it. It was just coming out. And then I felt, hey, this is really good material, and so I felt that I needed to keep it. Many of the works that I do follows that similar procedure, and this just happened on a much larger scale over a much longer time frame.
That's great. Every composer is an individual to her or himself, and so the process is always different. It doesn't belong in a book. You don't glean knowledge of how to compose from between two covers of a book. You find out who you are, how you work, and it's great. How would you describe the sonic language of this? The reason I ask him this, everybody, is so that I know how to conduct this piece next. No, we are always, as musicians, we're always interested in finding out the expressive language of the piece so that we can render it. We're not just gonna cut and paste some idea of some preconceived notion of the piece or some other composer's ideas, but I want to hear you talk to them about the sonic language of this.
Well, the first thing I should mention is the Copland and the Bernstein, both wonderful pieces on this program. They're very melodically driven. A lot of that music, the harmonic rhythm is dictated by the melody that supersedes it, and the way that the piece progresses, whether it be in melody or form or texture, very much happens over this melodic arc that tends to justify the architecture of the piece. Whereas this work of mine is not that so much. It's much more driven by the development of textural and timbral materials and focuses on the transformation of these small little motivic cells that dictate how the piece begins to play out. So sonically, it's not, I don't want to say it this way, but it's not as sweet as the Copland was. There is a bright polychord at the very opening of the work that really sets what the piece is going to sound like. And from there, there are moments of sweetness, of a consonant dissonance, if you will, but then the end of the work is just very brash, very loud and angry. So there's a lot of moods in this piece, and it fluctuates very wildly over the 20 minutes that it occurs. And sonically, I mean, you don't really know what to expect in a given moment. And that's what allows me to mess with your expectation as to what's going to come next, right? So whereas, with some works, you can start to kind of predict where things are going. If you can do that with my work, come find me and tell me, because I'm going to be really impressed.
Oh, that's great. Is there anything, just in closing, that you want to tell the audience that you think might be helpful to them in engaging this piece? Or maybe you've covered it already.
Well, I want to mention definitively that music inherently has multiple ways to be interpreted, and we can listen to the same piece in multiple different ways, and this work is no exception to that. There's certainly a melodic arc that warrants its own reward, but there's also the harmonic development of this idea that I present. There's also the development of these small cells, and as the work progresses, you can hear sort of how that's either interpolated or set in retrograde or inversion, that kind of thing. So there's the technical sort of listening side to this, I think, could warrant a lot of positive response. There's also just the sheer aesthetic of it, right? Just following the dramatic arc of the piece and just, enjoying somebody hitting this loud wooden box at the end. I mean, it's just something really pleasurable about that, right? So there's the aesthetic value to the piece as well. I mean, there's so many ways that you can think about enjoying the work, and I just encourage you to keep an open mind and open ear in terms of doing so. And one of the things that I would really like to advocate for is a personal relationship, to find something personal about what you hear that you can relate to your own life. And for many years as a composer, I tried to consciously avoid this, right? To try and remove some of my personality so that I didn't have to bare myself to the outside world, to audiences or to whoever. And that's really no way to be. We become our best selves when we're very open and honest with everybody that's in our lives, be important or small. And I encourage you to find something that you can relate to in this. There's a lot that I can relate to in this. I mean, I'm sure all of you have been in a place where you just get so angry that you want to punch a hole in a wall, right? You hit this big wooden box, so I can symbolize that, right? Or maybe it takes you someplace more comforting in that way. Whatever that may be, I just encourage you to find any way that you can relate to what's happening on stage and find multiple ways of enjoying what's here, my primary goal as a composer is to make my performance happy and give you an enjoyable listening experience. And if I can do that at the end of the day, then my job is done. So thank you for all the work that you have done on this, and thank you to this wonderful, wonderful orchestra. And thank you all for being here. It's my pleasure to be with you. See you.
I'll say one other thing. You'll notice a procession of three percussionists who will come out and be in your region. If you're sitting next to a bass drum, please know that that will be played. And please also know that this box called a Mahler box that he referred to will also be played. And it's at the end, right at the end of the work. I don't usually like to give things away like that, but it's important because it's shocking. And it's intended to be. So be aware of that. And I don't think it's necessary to plug your ears at all. It's not that sort of jarring sense, but it's very present, and you'll remember it. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. Lord.